Wow. Wow, wow, wow. Welcome to wowism. I call it that so I don't call it meditation, because meditation has so many, many, many connotations. You start thinking, listening here, listening there. It's a swamp, terrible swamp. So this is really, because what is this really? Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. I like it way better than saying we're meditating. No, we're full stop in the wow. Practicing wowism. So this is how progress is made. There's no question about it. I can say that this, I feel I'm on the right track. And tremendous progress is being made. It's being effective. Now, what is the secret? I can tell you the secret here. I can share the secret. It's open secret. I want to share the secret. I experienced it again this morning. Very clearly. There is a secret, and we're going to go into that secret in this video. But first, keep in mind, the practice is full stop in the wow, meaning your functionality is going to dip a little bit, okay? When you're shocked by the good news, and this is very good news we have for you, extremely good news. When you're shocked by this extremely good news, your functionality takes a dip. This is why we sit quietly and full stop in this wow and just get used to it. And then once you get used to it, your functionality returns again. You may not as strong as you might hope for. You know, you're not a world beater, but your basic functionality is fine. It's just you're not some real clever, devious, clever person who's able to make all these crude representations of reality. You don't really have that functionality, which is a great thing, which is really good, because that's what we don't want to do. We do not want to spend our time making crude representations of experiencing, of essence, and trying to make this house a home. That is the big mistake. So our functionality will just be basic. You know, we won't be anything special at all. You're able to drive, talk, shop, eat, sleep, just do everything. Work, you're able to do everything, okay? You're just not you won't be a standout. But just fine. Don't need to be. Now, so what I have to share is going to be very good news. Very good news. Because if you can see it, you will recognize that you know the secret to success. Okay, so that will produce a wow. Your functioning will dip. You need to be patient and let it, of its own accord, gradually you reassemble your functionality around this new realization, okay? So you have to be patient. This is the whole key, is patience, sitting quietly, patiently, having that discipline. Now, it's not easy for anyone. I mean, we all have this urge, like we need to be world beaters, we need to be special, we need to be exceptional, you know? And so, of course, we're that's pulling us, but we have to use our spiritual will and say, no, I want to hear the good news. I want to accept the good news, and the good news is absolutely tremendous. Now, Just take a moment here. We're going to look at this. I have to summon the will to look at it. Now what you find is if you have some event pending, things pending, schedule pending, you won't be able to summon the will. You'll feel like, well, I don't want my functionality to dip too much, so I can't do this. This is the problem. So this is what I'm experiencing right now. The schedule's a little uncertain about today. So I'm feeling like, wow, I don't know if I really can have my functionality dip down too far, you see? And then this prevents you from looking really deeply, which is why oftentimes meditation is done early in the morning where, you know, there's nothing pending. Like I woke up at 5 in the morning and so it's not working today. So I have a lot of time just to contemplate and feel my functionality dip a little bit. That's fine, no problem. Or late in the evening time where, you know, you're going to go to bed after this, you don't have to function at all, then you can have your functionality dip way down and it's not a problem. And by functionality, I mean you're planning, you're scheming, all this stuff. It seems to like say, I don't need to do that anymore. And so then you're not sure what to do. It's not that your body's not functioning. Your body's fine. It's just that your mind is not sure what the plans are. What are the plans? I don't know. Maybe I don't need any so much, you know. And so you're not just sure. You're not sure what to do. So it seems like you're not functioning well. Because we're not familiar, lack of familiarity, where we're a little hesitant. We say, when we get familiar with something, a job, we can just do really easy, right? But when you're not familiar with it, you struggle. So as you get this good news, you're not familiar with it, so you'll struggle. You're not sure, I'm not sure how to function with this good news. This is the issue, big issue. Okay, I'm not sure how to function in the light of this good news. Now, I realized this morning, how I got pulled down. And I realized if I get the answer to not getting pulled down, I won't suffer anymore. So I'm literally just one answer away from being free from suffering forever. And I realized this. I'm just one simple answer away from being free of suffering forever. So what did I do? Did I frantically try to get that answer? No. Immediately I said, okay, great. Now, what I'm going to do, and here is the secret. So, all ears here. I am, instead of trying to make that final step forward into freedom from all suffering forever, instead of trying to do that, I am going to do what? See, this is the question, right? What am I going to do? I'm in this situation. I was literally in this situation this morning. I still am. Just one simple answer away, one clarification away, and I am free. So I said, okay, what are my options? Well, what I realized and what I said is, took the position of, okay, what am I going to do? I'm going to use all my effort and attention and focus, not to take a step back, to avoid taking a step back, okay? So I am just going to full stop in the wow of this closeness to freedom. I am just going to work on staying where I am and not taking a step back, because I realize if I try to take a step forward without getting used to the wow of being so close, I'm going to panic about my functionality, and then I'm going to start taking steps backwards. And before you know it, I'm in full retreat. So the secret is to work on not retreating, not staying right where you are, and not taking one step backwards. This is why I call it full stop in the wow. You full stop there. You're not trying to go forward. You're not trying to go backward. And so You work on remaining just where you are. Because the wow is already here. You already know you're super close. You don't need to keep going on over and over that. No, you need to make sure you don't retreat. And so this is where the discipline comes into play. And this is why I'm saying you have to practice and keep working at this step by step. Because sooner or later you're going to get to the step where you realize you're only one step away. What are you going to do then? You see, you can't retreat then, because what happened? Well, you simply obviously don't want to retreat. So you have to get to the eventually one step away, and then stay there. Stay right one step away for now until I get used to functioning with the knowledge that I'm just one step away from liberation, from all suffering forever, just one step away. And get used to that. Hold that intensity. Hold that wow. Don't retreat. Because once, as soon as you retreat, you begin to rationalize the retreat. And as soon as you begin to rationalize, you get thrown into all of the intellectualisms, the emotionalisms, the clevernesses. You begin to rationalize it. And then the anxiety arises, you retreat more. In other words, when you leave the wow of it, anxiety arises. Rationalization, thinking, and all of these troubles arise. So you do not want to retreat. That's the first order of business. When you make an advance, the first order of business is then you do not want to retreat. That's the first order of business. It's not, let me grab, let me make that last leap. That is not the first order of business. First order of business is do not retreat. Because you will then get into rationalization. And the closer you are to success, the greater the rationalization will have to be. And you get stuck in trying to become some great rationalizer. That's definitely what you don't want that. Remember, we don't yet have the answer. Okay? So, retreating, you won't have the answer. Just be rationalizing. You have to rationalize. Why did you retreat? Oh, well, all the troubles arise. So, above all else, do not take a step backward. Or minimize it. If you take a step backward, recenter yourself. That's fine. Okay, recenter yourself. Continuity problem is the only problem I have. I'm practicing full stop on the wow. My functionality is a little bit down from this wow. That's okay. And so you don't think and try to solve what is the answer. You don't try to get the answer. You see, this is what I say. Full stop, it means you're not trying to advance anymore. You're putting all your attention on not retreating. Because the familiarity problem, will automatically try to pull you into retreat. Automatically. This is the insidious nature of nature, is that we're familiar with it. This is the snake, the subtle insidiousness. As we wait here in nature, waiting for this the final question to be resolved, which is, did God mandate this for us or not? This is the question. Now, theoretically, we can see it, but to get it actually finally resolved, where are we waiting for that to happen? You see, where are we waiting for that for that final clarity? Where are we waiting? We're waiting in nature. Nature totally biases against it. Against it, it brings this severe bias into us. Where we're presuming that God did mandate it, and so we're trying to get used to what the new changes, what the changes are going to be in reality. We're trying to use this world to get used to those, what those changes are going to be, and we're totally biased. Plus, we're completely familiar with nature, completely familiar with it. And this is what we don't realize. Be it ever so humble, there's no place like home means you try to go somewhere better, and the familiarity keeps pulling you back. So for sure, there's a pull, strong pull back to retreat. And this is what you must not retreat. You must use all your spiritual will to not retreat. Say, I'm going to stay right here. And do not allow your mind to be tricked into trying to figure out what is the answer, because then you're using all that effort, and before you know it, familiarity is pulling you backwards. The pull of familiarity pulling you backwards. So, I'm just saying, okay, I'm one step away, one answer away. Okay, this is where I'm at now. I'm one answer away. This is where I'm living. This is my home right now. So what we do is we have like a mobile home, and we keep moving it closer and closer. But we move to another campsite, we set up camping there, and this is our home for now. Okay, but simple, it's still mobile, right? We're not trying to have this home, this permanent, home foundation, concrete foundation. We have a mobile home. We're moving it bit by bit, moving it bit by bit. This is where I live now. This is my home. My home is one step away, one answer away from liberation. Okay, fine. I'm not trying to move my home at this point. I have a nice campsite, put a little fire, cook some food, and this is where I'm staying for now. I don't have any timetable one way or the other. This is whenever I feel like, hey, it's time to move on from this campsite, then I'll move on. So we're not trying to construct a house where we are. We already have this mobile home, which is our spiritual practice, which is Wowism. This is a mobile home. And we're just camping, a little campsite, that's all. I'm gonna hang out, just for a little bit. Hang out by a lake, maybe, and just... and the ego, our continuity fear is saying, hey, why don't you finish? Why don't you finish? You're not finishing because it's not there. You're not finishing because it's not there. See, you're not taking the last step because it's actually not there. And you have to, brush those aside. A full stop in the wow. No. Say, well, whatever. Whether it's there or not, I want to be close in case it is there. You see? So it hasn't been proven it's not there. In fact, I feel that it's most likely is there. So I certainly don't want to retreat from this where I'm at. And the continuity fear says, no, it's not there. And when you find out it's not there, you'll be so disappointed, and you'll have to retreat so far into darkness. It's better that you retreat back a ways towards darkness, just so you don't get so disappointed. And I say, no, I'm staying right here. If I have to retreat, I can retreat. Okay, that's no problem. I'll be able to do that. But certainly, I don't want to take a step backwards, because I very much have feeling that, there is an answer to this. So, I'm not going that nothing is there. It's not proof at all. It's proof I have a continuity issue. See? So, again, in the practical secret of accepting that I only have one problem, it's the continuity problem, is it nullifies this egoic trickery that it does. The ego says, hey, the fact that you're not advancing means it proves it's nothing there. And if you can't counter this by saying, no, it does not prove it, it only proves that I have a continuity problem, a familiarity problem, at most. It doesn't prove something is there or not there at all. But it does prove I have a continuity problem, so I want to make sure the continuity problem is not biasing me against, you know, against that's thinking that there's something there. In other words, our continuity problem biases us, and we easily believe, oh, the reason I'm not advancing is because there's nothing there. There's no truth there. You know, there's no answer to my problem, my question I have. Easily biases us. So when you accept that I have a severe continuity fear, it's the only problem I have, you see, then this nullifies this dynamic. You're saying, no, I'm staying right where I am because of my continuity problem. This is called humility or repentance. This is what works on the path. It's essential. Absolutely essential. Or you'll just be wandering around and defining that wandering as success or progress or something. But no. So, again, the reason why I stop short in that sense, just stop, full stop, is because of the continuity issue. And the wow issue, the wow issue, and the continuity issue is wow is part of the continuity issue. In other words, I'm not used to the good news. It's the good news is so great. It's like, wow, I need to stop here. It's just like, how will I function? So the continuity problem is the only problem I have. This is why I stopped. And just remain resolute about that. And then you'll get used to where you are. If you remain resolute and don't retreat, how can you get used to where you are if you retreat from it? How can you get used to a new campsite if you say, you know what? You get there and you say, oh, I don't want to stay here, and you go back to the old campsite. And you start retracing. No, I don't like this. I'll go back. And you go back a number of campsites. And then, of course, then each campsite you go back, you say, oh, I don't like this place, because actually you've gone beyond that, right? You know something better. And then you misinterpret that and think, oh, the reason why I don't like this is because it's not so good. There's nothing ahead for me. So I better go back another step and retreat like that. As soon as you stop understanding that your only problem is the continuity problem, you will end up in a retreat mode, and it goes on and on and on. And we all get hit by this. I know I got hit by this so many times. I would make a great advance, and then I'd end up retreating way back again. And I'd say, wow, terrible. What happened? And I'd try again, and happen again, over and over and over and over and over. And until I began to, you know, gradually recognize that the severity of the continuity problem is what we all overlook. So if we say, oh, I don't want to stay here because there is no next step, we'll retreat. And then we'll look about as far as advancing again. We say, oh, no, I don't want to advance because that place is no good because there's nothing there. So let me retreat one more step. And then why'd I retreat? Rationalize it. Oh, because that other place didn't have anything I liked, and there's nothing beyond that really, so I'll retreat another step. And it just, you go step by step, you just retreat, and you can't seem to halt the retreat, right? Everyone's experienced this probably many times, as you feel you simply cannot halt the retreat. And then you get despondent. You say, what's happened? And then you say, the spiritual path doesn't work. You get angry, you get depressed. Whereas if you say, no, I only stopped here because actually I'm realize I've made tremendous progress, and I can feel just how close I am to success, and it's actually, I'm seeing little snippets of it, just wow. And so I have this continuity problem is the reason why I stopped here. Not because there's nothing, no answer there. So I don't need to retreat at all. I'm not going to retreat. I'm going to camp right here. This is where the will has to come in the clarity and the practice. The benefit of this practice is you will have less and less retreating taking place on your path. Less and less retreating. And when that happens, the progress then becomes very substantial. Because you'll step by step, you'll hold on to your progress. You'll make progress and you'll stay there for a little while, and then you'll make more progress, you'll stay there, you'll make more progress and stay there. As I said, the tortoise wins the race. Tortoise is bringing his camper shell with him, right? Whereas the hare is, he takes it, goes fast, and then suddenly, retreat. And it loses all its progress that it's made and ends up getting nowhere. Whereas the tortoise moves its shell, moves it, and it camps there. It says, okay, now I'm ready to go on. I can go a little further. Now I'm going to camp right here. And a little further and camp right here. The tortoise wins the race. Most assuredly, the tortoise wins the race. So in the mind say, well, what is the answer? What is the answer? No, we're not entertaining the answer right now. I don't even want the answer right now, okay? See, this is the key. See, I don't want the next step right now. I'm not ready for it. So you see, admit to it, I'm not ready for that final step right this moment, okay? So I don't want it, so I'm not gonna try and get it or anything. I'm just gonna get used to being this close. I'm going to get familiar with being this close. Also, the benefit of this path, wowism, full stop in the wow, is you're also saying, I'm not going to try to make any crude representations of any of this jewel-like glimpses that are sort of occasionally get a little glimpse of like, wow, it's like a jewel-like beauty. I'm not going to try and make any crude representations to calm my continuity fear. Because then you say, hey, I need to make something a little better. And before you know it, your whole life is built up around trying to make crude representations. And it's impossible to perfectly represent or define reality. Completely impossible. In fact, no definitions are even impossible or possible at all about reality. Reality is completely free. So you do not try to make representations. You're just camping. You're not making any representations. Because those people who claim that they can't take this path, they're mistaken. They absolutely can't. Everyone can. So you don't need to make some crude representations of essence to make them feel happy about their lives because they can't do this. It's not necessary. No. So for the moment, you say, this is what I am right now. I am, this is where my house is, one step away from liberation. This is where I'm at. And you have to hold that against the pressures, you know. Just hold that. Not planning for how you're going to function in this way, or how you won't function. Not trying to say, well, how long am I going to stay here, or, you know, or how short of a time am I going to stay here? No, just for right now. This is my home. This is my daddy. This is where I'm at right now. Just living in this wow, the wow of being one step away. Wherever you're at, the wow of being only a few steps away, or the wow of getting close. See, wherever you're at, just the wow of that. Like, wow, I'm approaching the promised land. Wow, I see it in the distance. Wow, this is where I'm at now. I'm approaching the promised land, you see. Wherever you're at on the path, there's always this wow, because you see you're getting closer. You see your success. Here's an example. Let's say you've been searching for this great treasure cave, Alibaba's treasure cave, and it's full of the most incredible, beautiful, jewel-like emanations. And you finally reach, and you see the cave, and there it is, and you're right on the brink of walking into this cave. You see it, it's there. What do? You walk in? No, no. You sit down right at the entrance, is what you do. And his first order of business is, don't retreat from this. You say, look, I know I'm really close, so that's not a problem. The problem is if I retreat, that's the problem. So I'm just going to sit here at the entrance of this treasure cave and just relax and sit and say, this is where I'm hanging out now. This is what I am, of course. And someone will scream at you and say, what an idiot. You know, you're right there by the cave. Why don't you go in? You know, you must think there isn't any treasure there. So you don't deserve it because you don't think there is. You know, they'll try to mess with your mind, you know, or mess with your will. And just continuity fear. I'm humble. Be meek, humble, unassuming. I have a severe continuity. I have a very bad problem, is what I have. Problem isn't that there's no treasure there. The problem is I have a severe continuity fear. That's my problem. It's the only problem there is. So I'm happy to admit I have this problem, and I'm dealing with this problem. I'm going to sit down at the entrance of the cave and just chill out here. Just sit full stop in the wow. I'm not going to even look into the treasure at this point. That's so overwhelming. I'm just going to just make sure that I don't retreat. Make sure that I don't retreat. This morning, so close, I began to sort of, in my awareness, is like there's these divine sparks, like jewel-like sparks, sort of rising, like from some source, you know, like sparks from a fire. You know how a fire sends sparks up into the dark night. And so let's say you're floating in the dark night, and there's a fire beneath you. You don't even know there's this beautiful fire. And yet, as you're sitting there staring out into the darkness, suddenly the sparks that this fire is causing to arise up into the air, suddenly a spark comes up like right past you, like, and you watch it and you say, wow. Some more sparks. You say, my gosh, that was beautiful. And then you think, like, you know, it seems like the sparks are coming from somewhere below me here, you know. And what do you do then? Full stop in the wow. You see, you've had the realization already. You see, I think I know where these sparks are coming from. And most likely there's a whole fire there of beauty, right? So you already got it. So immediately full stop. And make sure you don't retreat from this. Float up higher in the sky where there's no sparks will get to you, you see. No, just stay right where you are. Say, I'm close to the source. Okay, good, I'm close to the source. I'm getting evidence that I'm close to the source. Wow. So if there's a few sparks coming up past me, just say, okay. I'm not going to try and, you know, open up a jewelry store around some design that I can get from these sparks. I'm not going to try and do anything. I just let the sparks arise and just notice, okay, very beautiful, very nice. But my first order of business is not to retreat. Because you know this is just the tip of the iceberg. Just the tip of that. So, you know, you've got plenty of wow left here. So your first order of business is just don't retreat. Just don't retreat. So you have to be focused on that. Not on trying to graphically represent some super crude representation of essence, you know. Because all attempts to represent essence are incredibly crude. Foolishly crude. So don't do it. I know the computers enable us to draw all sorts of fancy fractals and everything. It's still incredibly crude. At best, it'll always be ridiculously, outrageously crude, actually. Outrageously crude. So don't do something outrageous, like by trying to represent it. Just say, wow, I must at least realize I still have a big wow factor going. So my first order of business is don't retreat. Don't retreat. Again, the dichotomy we're trying to determine is, on one hand, we believe that we can forget all about our divinity. On the other hand, we're saying, no, we cannot. And so, if certainly this is the crucial issue. Can we forget all about our divinity, actually? The divinity is one. Obviously, if we co-create another reality, which is based on lack of freedom, that's getting too analytical. Let's just say this is the dichotomy. Smart thing to do then is, until this is finally, ultimately determined, let's at least put ourselves in a position where, if it turns out that we cannot forget our divinity at all, it's impossible, we will easily then be able to resolve the remaining continuity fear. It won't be, you know, some supremely difficult situation. Let's at least be that smart. And then if it turns out we can forget about our divinity, we'll be in a position where we'll be able to, you know, work on forgetting it too. Let's at least be that smart. I mean, that's the very least of intelligence we can use. I mean, that's just like, if you don't even use that, you're not using any intelligence at all. It's just blind faith is what we're using. Completely blind faith. That's not intelligence. So, you know, we have to use at least a tiny bit of intelligence, of reason, a tiny bit. And to use that tiny bit, as you say, is obviously, wow, let me not be too extreme here. Go on blind faith that we're going, that forgetting about reality is something we can do. We have that function. We can create that function for us, that we're able to completely forget about what we are. Let's not have blind faith in that. Let's at least be smart enough to hedge our bets on this one. You know, because it's so outrageously unlikely. Let's at least hedge our bets. Hey, you know, that's just being smart. So I would say people are trying to be completely stupid. I mean, trying to be fundamentally stupid here. There's no question that's what everyone's doing. They're not hedging their bets at all. They're not saying, wow, wait a minute. You know, what if it goes the other way? They're trying to put all their eggs into one basket. And then in that stupidity, trying to maintain the stupidity through sensuality, you know, trying to cheat thrills. Now, when you're thinking, you're trying to advance and not full stop in the wow. So just say, well, okay, I just made an advance, so let me now get used to this advance. Let me not keep thinking about more advance at this point. As soon as you realize that, you drop all these trains of thoughts. Just let them go. Pull, don't need them. The weight is off your mind like that. So the spiritual path is really when you decide that you're not going to be totally stupid, you're not going to try to be totally stupid, you're not going to practice total stupidity, that's all. You decide that you're not going to practice total stupidity. Because those who are not on the spiritual path are literally practicing trying to be totally stupid. Trying to be totally stupid. And when you decide, you know what, I'm not going to try to be totally stupid anymore, automatically the spiritual path begins for you. Automatically. Because reason then is there. A little bit reason. You say, hey, wait a minute. Let me hedge my bets on this. You know, it's obvious. Wow. Because I could be in a real bad spot if it turns out that I can't forget divinity. I'm gonna have a massive continuity problem here. I won't know how to function. And therefore I must be rooting against it. You know. And that bias is then that I become a fanatic of rooting against that and rooting for forgetfulness of reality. So I become a fanatic and I'm completely biased. My judgment becomes completely biased. Obviously, then you immediately see this, whoa. When I'm trying to be completely stupid, I end up being totally biased because I'm afraid of a possible continuity problem. You see? You say, uh-oh. I have a severe continuity problem, so I've got to make sure that I succeed in forgetting reality. You become biased, you become fanatics. So I would say this world is more than an insane asylum, it's a place of fanatics who are fanatically insistent on stupidity, total stupidity. They're rooting for forgetfulness of we can somehow have some function, we can become totally oblivious to reality, what we are, and freedom. We can totally oblivious, no attraction anymore whatsoever. This is, the world is rooting for that, rooting for it. And we're I see the world, everyone's helping each other maintain this fanaticism. This is what I see. Whatever you need, they say, whatever you need to maintain this fanaticism, we're here for you. We're here for you. I'll give you a tweet, like you on Facebook, we'll share some graphics, we'll share some philosophy. So I see this whole, like a cult of fanatics in this world, doing whatever it takes to maintain this loyalty and faith to this fanaticism. Because they feel that if they don't, the continuity fear is going to overwhelm them. But what happened with me was I said, I cannot bear total stupidity. I said, no. This was a decision. My spirit said, no, I'm not totally stupid. This is what happened to me. The ego claimed I was totally stupid. I reached the point where the ego was insisting, you're totally stupid. This is what it tried to get me to buy into. And after I saw I cannot adjust to the chaos, I realized it's not possible. And I said, the ego said, you're totally stupid. I said, no, wait a minute. I just realized I cannot adjust it to chaos. Therefore, that's some intelligence right there. And I said, hey, I'm not totally stupid. In fact, I can never be totally stupid. And that broke the spell of the ego. And then I began, the spiritual path began. So I decided I'm not going to try to be totally stupid. And then reason began functioning for me automatically, just like that. So again, this world is a place where we go to try and be totally stupid. Become fanatics of stupidity. Why? Because we're anticipating a potential extreme continuity problem should it turn out that we cannot get rid of the attraction we have for reality. Well, if you're not totally stupid, you will say, hey, wait a minute. I do have a severe continuity problem already. And if I keep trying to be totally stupid, it'll just get worse. So the only thing for me to do is start working on this continuity problem. After all, since it's a continuity problem, it's solvable. It's just, I mean, I need to get to work on it. And that's what the Holy Spirit told me. He says, the only problem you have now is this continuity problem, and it's just a matter of getting to work on it, and you will evaporate it eventually, and you'll succeed. Guaranteed. The Holy Spirit said, guaranteed. It says it's going to take you some time, but what else is what else do you have to do in this world, really, except do this? This is exactly what happened in my case. I know this is what happens in everyone's case, is they simply stop trying to be totally stupid. That's it. And then automatically reason is there for them, automatically. They say, hey, I'm not totally stupid. I just realized that total stupidity is totally stupid. It's really stupid. And then said, hey, I'm not totally stupid. I'm just smart. I suddenly realized I've just used my intelligence. I use my reason. Wow. So everybody will get started on the path eventually. Everyone. And the continuity fear, the evaporation happens faster than you might think. It seems like it might take forever, but it doesn't. No. You gain momentum and you start getting leverage. So we do not have to make arrangements for the totally stupid and try to make their lives more comfortable for them as if this is their home forever. We do not have to do that. Because the spiritual path will start for them at some point, for sure. And we're not hastening the beginning of it by trying to make their, you know, crude representations of essence here to make them more comfortable with their stupidity. That doesn't help. So as these divine sparks go past us, we just say, okay, that's fine. This is where I'm at now. These divine sparks are arising for me. Okay. We're not trying to represent what's better than this. We're saying, no, full stop, in the wow of this. Let me not retreat. My first orbit is let me not retreat. So we're not trying to get pep talks to push off, go all the way. No, no, no. First order of business, don't retreat. And as soon as we feel comfortable where we're at, automatically the attraction of intelligence will allow this attraction. Say, let me get closer here. Your intelligence will say, yeah, getting closer here, let me hedge my bets, let me go closer, let me get some more sparks. This is just a very faint sparks of the divine attraction. Just, these are just sparks of divine attraction is all. So let me get more of this, because so if it turns out I cannot overcome this attraction, I will not have such a tough continuity problem left for me, right? Just, it's a no-brainer. It's obviously the smart choice. See, the world's not trying to be stupid. There are people get really upset when, are you calling me stupid? No, I'm saying you're trying to be totally stupid. Which is impossible, you see. Trying to be totally stupid. This is like a huge effort, right? And the world sees this as some magnificent, idealistic, you know, great endeavor to be succeeded at. Am I calling people crazy? No, they're trying to be totally crazy. They're trying to be totally crazy. Not just crazy, that's not the goal. They're trying to be totally crazy. They're trying to be totally insane. They're trying to be totally stupid. This is the goal here. As soon as you give up on that goal, reason is born. The child of reason is born within you. You become aware of this. This child gradually leads you closer and closer to wait in a less biased situation. Because with this world is again totally biases us with the familiarity problem. Totally. And extremely so. Let's put it this way. Extremely biased towards trying, you know, to believing in total stupidity is the way. Extremely biased, which is a reckless bias, a very reckless bias. It only makes things worse. So don't put all your eggs in that basket. Sit in a situation where you can see the dark sky, okay, the darkness, the dark sky's there, and yet all these divine sparks are also there. And you can say, well, you know what, I could go either way on this. If push comes to shove, you go either way. I'm used to the divine sparks now, and I'm also used to the background, the darkness, the background, the dark. So either way I could go, if I had to. This is way smarter, right? Way, this is just basic smartness, actually. It's just simple smartness. So people are just telling me, you think you're so smart? No, I just have a little bit of smartness. They say, are you calling me stupid? No, I say, you're trying to be totally stupid. As some great accomplishment, you know. Obviously, that would be a great accomplishment if you could be totally stupid. It means you could, you know, completely forget about reality. But I'm saying, you haven't attained it yet. And I'm saying, you haven't attained it yet. And so, obviously it's smart. I'm just a little smart. I'm not some smart aleck, not some know-it-all. Just a little bit smart. Hedge your bets. Is not to try to represent these divine sparks. So look how creative I am. I can be some great artist. No, it's to get used to this. Get used to it. Get familiar with it. Let all these divine sparks come and go. Fine. I'm just getting used to fighting this jewel-like situation of all this jewel-like divine sparks, you know, rising. I'm just getting used to that as well as the background is still there. I'm already used to that, you know, used to nature, the background of darkness, so to speak. I'm still used to that, too. So just get used to the situation, that's all. Because the situation is not, how clever can I be representing this? No, the situation is ultimately to know the answer. Did God mandate that we create a separate co-reality or not? This is the ultimate question. Once that's answered, then, you know, it's all finished. That is answered, and that's it. So that's what we're waiting for. So don't realize that there's something very important we're waiting on. Crucial, totally crucial. Don't waste your time making the jewel-like representations or something. No way. Because then your attention gets off of the arising of these jewel-like sparks. And you won't get familiar with them then. You're too busy trying to cut a diamond, you know? And your attention's on that. That's you know, some very stupid. Don't put your attention on diamonds. That's an incredibly, outrageously crude representation, you know? All representations are outrageously crude. It's the spontaneity and the freedom and the non-crystallization and the appearance. It's the whole, it's the context of these divine sparks, you know, it's the attraction, it's all of that. It's all of that. It's way bigger, and it's also the attraction of intelligence. So be attracted by reason. And again, you say, first order of business, no retreat. And someone says, yeah, you've made some advancement, but really, there's, you know, the divinities need to know you haven't yet looked. That's stupid. That's not a teacher. A teacher is someone who says, the first order of business is no retreat. Once you see the divine sparks, first order of business, don't retreat. Don't say the first order of business, oh, where's the source of these divine sparks? Let me look there. Let me leap it. No, that is not the first order of business. This is the ego trying to frighten you away from getting familiar with where you're at, you see, on evaporating the continuity fear. So if you were to go, anyway, we don't need to make it complicated. First order of business is simply do not retreat, do not retreat. Where you're at. You start thinking, I remember I had success here and here and here and here and here, and start thinking, what was that success? Your attention gets off of where you're at right now. Where we're at is just one answer away, for me, we're one answer away from liberation, so. Now, I'm not thinking about previous successes right now. Try not to. That's why I say full stop in this wow of where we're at. The new wow of the new campground. The wow of the new closeness. It's always the wow of the new closeness to liberation. Wherever you're on the path, each day you will make progress and you'll say, wow, I'm closer now. And it will always be a wow. That's why I say it's wowism. The path is really wowistic. You see, I'm a lot closer today than I was yesterday. Wow. And it's the same all the way through the path. You have this wow, and it's just managing. I say managing your success is the key to success. And the first order of business in managing your success is don't retreat. Minimize your retreat for sure. Try not to retreat at all. And how you do that is get comfortable where you're at. Don't be entertaining anything about, well, how do I advance? But immediately you'll pull some fear in and start trying to work on it. No, don't do that. Just say, I'm resigned right this moment to be right where I am in the wow of this new campsite, this new closeness. And I'm just going, this is where I'm at right now. I'm going to get used to it. I'm not going to try to advance at this point right now. No. And I'm not thinking about future advancement. My first order of business is get used to where I'm at right now. Now, there are people who say they're stuck. And they say, no, see, if I do that, I'll get stuck. No, they're not full stopping in the wow. They're thinking too much about advancement and the previous advancements they've had. And so they're not spending any time getting used to where they are. So that's the problem. And then they conclude, well, the spiritual path doesn't work. That's not true. Is they're not following the advice at all. They're not full stopping. They're not trying to full stop. They're completely given over to future plans and past successes and all that. We're not paying any attention to future plans or past successes. We're just getting used to the closeness that we have right now. Which is the dip, temporary dip in functionality, you see. So you just say, well, I'm not used to this place where I am here, so I'm not going to be functioning that well. So that's okay. So you say, it's okay. I forgive myself for not being some super functional person right at this point. That's fine. I forgive myself for that. I know why. See, I know why. It's not because I'm stupid. It's because I'm experiencing this temporary shock of unfamiliarity with this closeness to liberation. Closeness to sanity, closeness to what I really want, closeness to something a lot better, you see. So I'm not experiencing a dip in functionality. Doesn't mean I'm stupid. Forgive yourself for not being super functional. Because that's not your first order of business, is get used to where you're at right now. Don't retreat. First order of business is don't retreat. So you're putting most of your effort into not retreating. And obviously, this is the key to success. The key to advancement is don't retreat. Once you've made advancement, don't retreat. The people who make advancements and then retreat, advances and retreat, and they say, oh, the path doesn't work. They're not using the key to success, which is first order of business is don't retreat. Once you make advancement, right away, first order of business, don't retreat. Work on that. Just work on the wow. Full stop in this wow. Just be aware of this wow. And don't analyze it. Because this wow is the ambience of where you're at right now. So by focusing on this, you are getting used to where you're at. And then once you really focus on it, and for long enough, then you feel, oh, okay, I'm comfortable here now. You reach a sort of a feeling like, okay, I can function here with this, great. And then once you do that, you're able then to take the next step, move your campground even closer to what you really want. But that's not the first order of business, it's first. Just full stop in this wow. Not anticipating wows in the future. Deal with the one you have right now. So it may not seem we're doing much, but we're actually doing what is absolutely essential, which is the first taking care of the first order of business. So we're taking care of business as we're quiet here, full stop. We're taking care of business. We're refusing to retreat. So, when you start wandering, say, what's the first order of business? Oh yeah, don't retreat. Okay, full stop in the wow. And you pull right back, you just drop everything you've been thinking of. Because, for sure, familiarity will try to pull you back. There's no question about it. So it's not like you're trying to be perfect. It's impossible with this continuity period to detain some, to have this ideal perfection. The familiarity is going to pull you back, for sure. It's going to try and pull you back, for sure, everyone. So you're just trying to keep from being pulled back, that's all. I mean, these temptations will come. The idea is that the temptations that come, oh, I guess I'm not ready for this, and then quit. That's ridiculous. The temptations will come at you in every possible way. It's subtle. Familiarity is trying to find some way to pull you back, to pull you into retreat. Absolutely, it works this way. This is the insidiousness of dwelling in this so-called nature realm. You get familiar with it. Even though you may hate it, you get familiar with it. It's insidious. And so this insidiousness will try to pull you back into familiarity, into where you're more comfortable. I'll go, come back to where you're more comfortable. Say, no, I'm going to work on getting more comfortable here. So it tries to pull you anywhere but where you're at, anywhere, future, past, you know, side trip, whatever. And you say, no, I'm uncomfortable right here, but I need to work on not retreating because I know this is getting close, really closer. So let me just work on getting comfortable with where I'm at right now. Thank you very much. Thanks, but no thanks. Not now. And we'll say, but you were so comfortable back where you were. And I say, well, yeah, but I'm... Where I'm at now is I want to be here more than where I was used to be because this is closer to where I want to get to. So, of course, I feel a little uncomfortable right now. I'm a little unfamiliar. But let me get used to it. So you definitely feel under siege in some way. And these insidious tactics keep pulling you back, and then you start to forget. So, whoa, what's my first order of business? Is what? Oh, don't retreat. Okay. So I'm starting to think about, what kind of spiritual practice can I use to help advance me from here? Whoops, what's my first order of business during this time? Don't retreat. That's my first order of business. And that's retreating, what I was just doing. It's retreat in the form of daydreaming about advancement. That's retreating from getting comfortable from where I am, you know, where I am right now. That is retreat. I already know that this has brought up a wow, which means it's tremendous advancement. That's already given, so of course this will be a retreat. When we really advance, it's not daydreaming, amusing like that. No, you're focused and you know you're advancing. You're not just daydreaming and idly thinking like that. No, that's a retreat. That's when you go into that mode of daydreaming and fantasizing and you know, that is retreating from awareness, retreating from where you are. Now, mindfulness training is like a type of training like this, but it's not an end in itself at all. No. It's not an end in itself. The idea that you can achieve some ability to focus your mind, you know, that's not the goal. That's not really the goal. The goal is to get into a situation where when the ultimate question is resolved, you will not be stuck in a continuity problem situation. That's the goal we have. Now, mindfulness training is full stop, is very helpful, full stop in the wow. But we have to keep every day, once we get that comfort zone, then we move further, and that shakes up our mindfulness. When people are trying to attain mindfulness, they'll say, well, progress disturbs my mindfulness, so I'm not going to get any. Oh, those divine sparks are disturbing my mindfulness, you know. It the means become an end in itself. This is a mistake. The means do not become an end in themselves. It's a tool. In other words, a spiritual path is not an end in itself. Spiritual titles and degrees and all this kind of stuff. Forget it. Just be comfortable with where you are. Just get comfortable with the wow of, hey, I'm closer. I'm a lot closer now. I see it. I just saw it. Wow. What's the first order of business? Don't retreat. For the confession of repentance, I have a very severe continuity problem. That's what's causing me the problem here. But it's the only problem I have. Solve this problem, and I won't have any other problems, actually. So just keep working on it. The other stuff is not problems. I don't have a success problem. I have a continuity problem. Yogananda said a saint is a sinner that never gave up, meaning someone who kept evaporating this continuity fear, kept making the first order of business, don't retreat. So gradually kept getting closer. You see, this is the way. Forgive yourself, say, I forgive myself for not advancing anymore at this moment and for struggling with this. But the first order of business is to get, don't retreat here. So I forgive myself, my functionality for not being so totally functional as the ego would like me to be, right? Make an idol of functionality here in this world. This is the big problem now. As I say, cosmic corporate culture idolizes functionality, and everybody is called to this more and more brisk functionality. So it's so difficult for me to drive in the Silicon Valley, because here people are obsessed with functionality. It's just an extreme obsession here, and everybody drives that way. You know, the driving reflects their obsession. They drive briskly and quickly and decisively and push this and push that and aggressively. Or, oh, I see a little room. Maybe I can save myself 2 seconds. Oh, okay, I'll take that. So you have everybody here like saying, how can I become more functional? Oh, if I do this, I can save like 2 seconds of driving time to my destination. Okay, let me do it. Yeah. And see, this is the mentality here. It's incredible how obsessed they are with functionality. And I say, well, I get there a second or two later, doesn't make any difference. Whether I missed a stoplight. I mean, it used to be like nobody ran red lights. I can tell you the difference in this Silicon Valley. What has happened with us, as the cosmic corporate culture incorporates this planet and brings in their idol of functionality, okay? You know, where the places, main places this has taken root. So having lived here my whole life, I can tell you the difference is like before, an orange light, people stop. Orange light, oh, slow down, stop, because it's going to go red, okay. Nobody ever ran a red light. I never saw it. Stick with this, okay. Now, more recently, I'm starting to see like a car just went right through. It's orange and they just kept going and turned red. He just went right through a red rug. What is that? It's like, wow, crazy. What's wrong with them? And people look at you, what's wrong with that idiot? You don't do that. Well, they saved themselves like a minute, maybe. 30 seconds a minute, maybe. And to them, it was worth the risk of a ticket or something because they're obsessed with trying to increase their functionality within nature. So they took the risk, okay. So then I started seeing more and more people, cars running red light. One car ran red light, another red light, another car. I said, wow, there's a lot of people here. This is very weird, very weird. Everybody commented, why are people running red lights like that? Wow. And then I began to see people running red lights that were even more egregious, like just flat out. The light would turn red before they ever even reached the intersection. And they just said, what the heck? I gotta save some time, just go right through it. That was shocking to see that. You never saw that in the past. Never, ever did you see that. Now, bring it up to right now, there's been a steady progression. What I'm seeing now is multiple cars running a red light at one light. Let's say there's like a left turn, it's a busy intersection. And you're sitting waiting here, and there's cars making a left turn out of a left turn. And you see your light turn green. And so you know that their light turned red quite some time before because there's a gap between when their light turns red and when your light turns green. Okay, there's a gap. So you don't have accidents. And so my light that turns green, and there's still a whole line of cars turning left. I mean, they're all running the red light blatantly. And you get like four or five cars blatantly running the red light at just one light now. This shows you the progression of the, why they say, oh, I can't, they're running the red light. And they said, I can't be inferior to them. I gotta prove my functionality. I'm gonna run it too. And the one behind it says, wait, there's two cars running it. I can't let those two get ahead of me. I gotta run it too. And so you're getting this chain now in the Silicon Valley of people that are so competitive with their functionality. It's a mania here. People buying houses that are worth, you know, in Shreveport, they might be worth, $50,000 or something. Maybe $85,000, I don't know. Here they're paying like $2 million for them. $2 million. Why? So they can get into the right school system. All right, which will get them into what? The right prep school, right? The right high school, it's a prep school. There are all these prep schools here. Once you get in those prep schools, then basically you're on the fast track to success. Graduate from those prep schools, you'll get into a better university, and you have this whole network of success and functionality now, you see. So that they're willing to pay like, you know, $2 million, ridiculously overpay, to get into the right school system for their children, and to prove, you know, how functional they are, to make their children so functional. Their obsession with functionality gets projected on their children, and they say the children becomes just symbols of their successful functionality, that I can raise a child who's super functional. And no wonder why the children are committing suicide and on antidepressants and everything like that here. There's a madhouse here. So you have these people just trying to save a second or two. So they're terrified of a dip in their functionality, because I've talked to those who are in school class, and they say, we can't even miss, you know, 10 minutes of a class. We come late, we're out. You know, they have to relentlessly keep up this massive pace of functionality, drinking coffee, energy drinks, drugs, taking, you know. So obviously, for them, a dip in their functionality based on the shock of the good news, like, oh my gosh, I just see how close I am to being completely free of all suffering and death, misery forever. To them, that would, they say, no, I can't do that. Because a little dip in functionality, everybody's gonna trample over me, and I'll get left in the dust. So you have this extreme antipathy towards the spiritual path here in the Silicon Valley. And this is all spreading all over the world, where functionality is the new religion. Enhanced functionality in nature is the new world order religion. And so the one thing they don't want anybody doing is the spiritual path I'm telling you, sharing with you right now. Is wow, is it? That's what they don't want. So if you're inclined towards that, what they're going to do is to try to divert you into good works. It's called into works. There's a big debate, of course, in religion, with salvation through works or through grace. And this is what split the Christian church into, the Catholic church into Catholicism and Protestantism. Is Protestantism says, Luther says salvation is through grace and grace alone, not through works. And the church said, no, it's you got to have both. But works are like super important. And so there's a big argument about this. And fundamentally, salvation is through grace. Okay, this is a fact. And what this idolatry of functionality within nature is doing is saying that if you want to be religious, that's fine, but you have to express it through good works. So if you're not expressing it through good works, you're a priori, you're denied religious status here in the world. So what they're doing is they're going to deny any religious status to anything that is not doing good works, and that will be bureaucratically regulated. Okay, centralized bureaucracy will regulate religion on this planet, and will insist that in other words, they don't want you to have any dip in your functionality at all. You see, because that actually means what? You just got the good news. You got a glimpse of the good news that you don't have. That of salvation, of freedom from misery and suffering and death. You got the good glimpse of eternal life. They don't want that. They want everyone to. They want to believe we can forget eternal life. We can cease to be attracted by eternal life. They say we can cease to be attracted by it. And so they want to divert all religious endeavor into good works. And this is what's happening on this planet. They'll give lip service to the other, but more and more they'll forget all about it. It's an anachronism. It's some kind of anachronism. This literally was taking place in this world. They want to keep you functioning all the time, trying to maximize your functioning. Go out and do this. Go out and do that. Go out and do this. Be functioning, instead of sitting quietly, and saying, I don't have to be totally stupid. Letting go of your reckless disregard for yourself, really. The world is in reckless disregard of itself. Being incredibly stupid and harsh on itself, because it's opening up the door to extreme continuity fear. What if we find out God did not mandate that we try to create a separate co-reality, and that light has never changed, and that reality has never changed, and God never asked us to change reality, and in fact it can't be changed, and we're completely free? What if that ends up being the actual, we realize this is the truth? Then we're gonna we have this terrible continuity fear of functioning within nature, within process, time, space, process, form, believing this is our identity. We realize we don't have to do any of this. We're completely free of this. And we say, no, continuity. So it's reckless disregard for our own happiness that is what this world is engaged in, and what the cosmic corporate culture is, just this outrageously reckless disregard for common sense, actually. The belief that salvation is through grace means God is still within us. We don't have to do anything to make that true. And that we can, at least, God is allowed, God says, feel free to at least take a position where you can go with grace or good works, either one, but make sure that you're at least equally familiar with the grace of God. At least equally familiar with, which means there's sparks of the divine you're experiencing and you're familiar with it. So yeah, I can go with that, no problem. And so this is what we have to work at, because in this world it's like geared toward 100% towards works. So we have to balance it out. And what cosmic corporate culture is saying is no balance at all. It's all going to be good works. This is an outrageous imbalance that they're bringing. Under the guise of they're saying that we need to balance things out. No, they're not. That's not their goal at all. It's completely obvious what their goal is. It's not to balance anything out. Because very few in this world are actually taking this path of grace, a path of wow, full stop on the wow. Very few already. It's almost like an anachronism extinction, almost extinct. So how is it that they're coming in and trying to make it completely extinct? How is that balancing anything out? It's obviously only one who's trying for total stupidity could see that as a attractive goal to them. That obviously. So if you're not trying to be totally stupid, you can obviously see what's going on here. It's blatant. But those who are trying to be totally stupid, they don't see it. They're like, oh yeah, okay. This makes sense to me. They say, oh yeah, sure. Trying to balance things out here. Trying to balance things out. Pope saying, we want to clear out everybody, these contemplatives. Come on, go out and do a worship. Don't be up there in your ivory tower contemplating. Get out, feed the poor and clothe the poor, do good works. I want a clean house here. Let's get everybody back on track and doing what Jesus really wanted us to do and all this stuff. Well, that's cosmic corporate culture right there. Exactly. That's what it's all about. That's what blatant. In other words, extinction of contemplatives, really, of that ideal. See, it easily goes extinct in this world if you don't preciously protect it, because the familiarity bias is so extreme here. If you do not make a concerted effort to protect the balance of grace and works here and the contemplative ideal, if you don't promote that, make a concerted effort to promote it as a very precious and important ideal here in this world, it will vanish. It will become extinct. Because the familiarity problem is so severely biases us here. Failure to recognize this is disaster for this culture and world society. As you retreat into works, then you want representations of the divine to say, this is good enough. We don't need to advance. It's right. You rationalize and you say, wait a minute, I have diamonds. I don't need the divine. I'm attracted. These diamonds are attracting us for me. And then what happens is then you become, since it isn't quite enough, you say, well, I just need a few more diamonds. And then that's still not quite enough. You say, well, I just need a few more. And you automatically become greedy, acquisitive, covetousness, you covet stuff, you become lustful, you become, you know, all these vices automatically start accumulating on you. Could you say, no, I just need a little bit more, I just need a little bit more. You get this greed overcomes you, covetousness overcomes you, lust for all this overcomes you, you become this monster. Absolutely. And you don't even hardly realize it's happening. You just say, no, I just need a few more representations so I'm attracted. This is sufficient. I don't need to be attracted to divine. I'm attracted to nature. Nature is my attractiveness. That's my home. You know, this is where I'm going to be living. This is my reality now. I just need a few more diamonds and jewels and money to buy them and more exotic clothing to wear. And I need to look more attractive to others so that they can serve me, my covetousness, you know, serve my greed. And then you get the mantra, greed is good, this is what's good for everybody. Or you get into this functional mania of, we need to just make sure that everything is distributed properly, everyone has diamonds, make sure everybody has this attractiveness in the world, so become obsessed with functioning that way. This is the good works obsession, that you have to be very careful that church religions don't fall into this trap. And unfortunately, this Pope, in my opinion, has lock, stock, and barrel fallen into this trap. Which is why they say he's the final Pope. Malachi's prophecies, this is the final Pope. Black Pope, this Pope, the Jesuit Pope, is the final Pope, Pope Francis. It fits the prophecy exactly. After that, New World Order. Extinction of this path of wowism. Where You're not concerned about your functionality. Your functionality. If I get there a minute or two late, that's fine. That's fine. I had a problem as a musician. I was obsessed with placing notes in the exact right spot, making scores. I wrote scores were exactly precisely right. That this note, you know, had to be timed perfectly. So I was obsessed with perfect timing. And so I came into this world and I had this thing about always being on time. I had to be exactly on time. If someone says, "Well, be there at 5 o'clock," I'd walk in as the second hand hit 5 o'clock. And it just happened. I don't know how it happens. So I was just being on time was like super important to me. Obsession. Because obviously you cannot have a beautiful jewel-like musical composition if the notes are timing is not right. See, everybody's listening. What is the timing? All the timing is exquisitely correct. And then we'll say, "Oh, that's such a nice jewel-like representation, you know, and how nice, you know, you've been functioning and slaving away nicely at this, and then this makes me feel more comfortable with staying in this world and forgetting about the attraction to divinity." Yeah. So I've had to struggle against this my whole life. I feel very nervous if I'm not on time. Slave away at just some little section, adjusting the timing, you know, over and over and over. Just see this. You know, it's like trying to make a jewel. It's like cutting a jewel. So trying to make this composition, just this jewel-like composition, all these strings, like a jewel necklace of diamonds, except musically, you know. And so that's what I did. But this caused severe problems for me. So now it's like, well, who cares if I miss the traffic light? I'll be a couple minutes, changed a couple minutes. That's okay. I'm not trying to be super functional here. This is not my home. Very doubtful this will be my home. Very doubtful. So obviously, I don't need to worry about making representations of reality if this symbolic representation, that symbolism is my new home. No, I don't think it's going to be. It might, but it's very unlikely it is. So the smart thing to do is get in sort of this intermediate position. So I can go either way depending on what the final answer is, you see. It's very stupid to put all your eggs into the basket of high functionality in nature, and high functionality of trying to symbolically create symbolic attraction. Attraction to symbolism. Attraction to symbolism. Attraction to definition is definitely what we're doing. We believe that the new reality is going to be definitional. And so we need to practice being attracted to definition and forget about attraction to freedom. Non-definition, formless freedom. But again, it's very stupid to put all our eggs into this basket. Because what if it's not true? What if God says, "No, I never said that I never mandated, I didn't create you to define what you are." Then you have to function as God created you to function. And you have a severe continuity problem. So it's stupid. Don't try to be totally stupid. Don't try to be a hero to those who are trying to be totally stupid. Don't try to be a hero because they'll drag you into obsession with high functionality, where you'll then be super competitive, try to take every possible advantage you can. It's like driving. It's like, wait, I can slip. I used to be that way. I had like a little sports car, and I was like, I could zip between cars, and you know, I could save time because I was stick shift and just super fast acceleration. Kill somebody, or you know, you're gonna kill yourself or somebody else. It's just reckless. And I realized, yeah, they're right. And I sold the car. I said, forget it. That's obviously so. But this is the way everyone drives here now. This is a place where those who are obsessed with high functionality come. Maybe that's why I ended up here. But now it's become a hell, because that's no longer my goal. this is all just being shared for the purpose of illustration, because this applies to everyone. The basics apply to everyone here. You know, the issue of trying to be totally stupid, the issue of backing off of that, the issue of familiarity, all these issues affect everybody. Everybody's trying to get somewhere really fast here. So again, we realize that when we make an advance and look with, and see the good news, we see the good news within us. That shocks us. We say, wait, how can I function? We take a dip in functionality. We're in the wow phrase where our functionality dips. And again, we have to guard this path like a precious jewel that it actually is in this world, because the world inherently has an enormous bias of familiarity, back to trying to be totally stupid. An enormous bias. So status quo for this world, the cosmic corporate culture is just saying, no, we're just trying to reestablish status quo on this planet. Well, status quo means extinction of the path of wowism, full stop in the wowism, means extinction of that. That's the status quo here. If you just allow status quo here, incredible bias we have here with a familiar nature. Nature's designed to give us this bias, and it does. It's going to distort our thinking and our clarity. And we'll say, oh, the goal is just to become super functional. That's status quo. So the whole purpose of religion is to guard, preciously guard, this path of contemplation. It's super important. This is their mandate. This is their goal. You can't have the head of the Roman Catholic Church saying, no, it works. It's fundamentally works. Hey, you call, you contemplatives, get off your lazy rear ends, get out there and start functioning. So what do they mean by functioning? What they're saying is, hey, get on the path of functionality. How can we? We'll help you. First, start out by feeding all the poor, clothing all the poor, and helping the sick. Start functioning that way, and then we'll work you into the greater functionality of progress, progress, progress. It's an obvious ploy to rid the world of the preciousness of a contemplative path. Again, the purpose of religion is to point out contemplative ideal is the highest ideal on this planet. It's the most precious ideal there is. And let everyone on the planet know that this is your road to your salvation. It's protect it, cherish it, nourish it. This is culture should protect and nourish the highest ideal, which is the contemplative path, which is this full stop in the wowism of allowing your functionality to dip as you progressively receive the good news, and you're temporarily stunned and shocked by it. And then you give yourself time to get used to it. This is the contemplative path. This is the precious jewel of this planet. And it's this that is under assault by cosmic corporate culture. And it's got its hooks into the religious leaders now, political leaders, social leaders, banking leaders, economic leaders, you name it. Everybody is now incorporated. That's how it incorporates a planet. And it says, no, we're just returning things to status quo, and we'll get back focused on super functionality, because this is the way. This is what cosmic corporate culture says. This is the way, super functionality, because they're anticipating. They believe that God is mandating the change in reality, so there'll be co-reality, two different realities. And they're assuming that this is the truth. This is an outrageously reckless assumption. I already know this is not true at all, but I cannot prove it here, okay? So, I can say it's an outrageously reckless, ridiculous assumption to make. And at the very least, we should be in a position so if it doesn't go that way, we won't have a severe continuity problem. This is the very least we can do. So all I'm saying is just do the very least you can do, actually. came up to the mailbox or something, I don't know. This is the very least we can do. This is the very least we can do. Now, the reason I'm not shouting this from the rooftops is because cosmic corporate culture is rabid at this point in time. You know, this stuff is just, it hates this. It's rapidly against it. It's very booster. Say, no, we're going to win. We're going to win. God's going to decide that this is all this attempt to separate and create a separate reality, that all this whole thing has been God's will for us all along. So we're not going to have any continuity problem at all. Don't worry, folks. We're not going to have any continuity problem. Let's all work on super functionality. This is their mantra. This is their religion. This is their religion. Now, we can say the Pope is a very good person. He's done a lot of good, and of course this is so. But there's one qualification for the pontificacy. That's the word. For to be Pope, there's one specific qualification that you have to have, and that fundamentally your first order of business is to protect contemplative society and to hold that up to the whole world as the ideal, the jewel that Jesus Christ informed us about and promoted and boosted for us. But if you don't have this quality, you should not be even sniff the papacy. Shouldn't be anywhere close to it. I don't care how good a person you are, how charitable. Pope Francis seems like a very nice man. But you should not be Pope. Plain and simple. He's much more a man of action than this. Should not be Pope. Should not be Pope. Should not even be a cardinal. Should not even be a bishop. Probably should be in the business sector of the world somehow, doing philanthropy. Should actually be a philanthropist. So, again, the Pope, the religious leaders, their first order of business is to safeguard contemplative ideal in this world, knowing the vast bias this world has against this inherently. This coming here to this world inherently induces an extreme bias against it. So we have to work and protect it, protect the church, the way that Jesus set up, the way that Jesus, you know, helped us with here. So I'm doing my little part, but I realize that this world's been incorporated by cosmic corporate culture and the contemplative ideal. Globally, the ideal has been determined and they tend to completely collapse it into good works. And it is collapsing into good works. The total collapse. So people will feel, oh no, we're very religious. We support religion 100%. I mean, even more so, the world will say, you know what? We actually are more supportive of religion now than the people who didn't used to be so much supportive. They said, oh, actually, we're really progressing and advancing because I feel like more supportive religion, more ecumenical. I'm able to, because we're finally getting down to the work this church is supposed to be doing. I think, what is that? I read someone, was the Pope or someone, religious person, saying that the heart, the core, the real essence, what Jesus' teaching is really about, what is really was just good works. That this is what it really is. And so people, the world will say, we're finally doing what Jesus wants to do us to do. And this, so we're really making great progress here. And the world will get caught up in this mania of thinking that they're advancing. They're not advancing, they're collapsing. They're just trying to be totally stupid so they don't know the difference. The advancement is, oh, we're all getting more functional. Even the contemplatives are giving up that foolishness and coming out and feeding the poor. Come on. You know. Again, nothing wrong with feeding the poor. What is wrong is holding this up as the highest ideal. This is what I believe that religion and the Pope is doing in the world, is holding up this up as Jesus, the highest ideal that Jesus came to teach us. That's absolute nonsense. Total inversion. Total inversion. It's putting works before grace. It's plain and simple. This is what cosmic corporate culture is all about. And it's ruinous. It leads to all the vices, inherently leads to all the vices, and then all the attempt to regulate the vices, which is what progressives are all about. They say, oh yeah, we got all these vices, don't worry, we'll regulate everything, that's fine. And then the more you regulate it, doesn't work. The vices are still there. And the corruption and the viciousness gets worse, and they try to regulate more, and the vices still, look at communist China, they try to regulate everything. Rampant capitalism is coming back, you know, greed. They're ruining their own country, they want to ruin Africa, the rest of the world, they want to take over. So because they're ruining their greed, lust for materialism, is ruining their country, it pollutes their country so bad they want to now go pollute the rest of the countries. Regulation, 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 for what? For higher functionality. The Chinese are functioning like crazy, like they're just like producing, 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 they can't take a second. You know, the regulation is so severe, they can't even take a second for hate. Let me just let my functionality drop here, because I just had the good news that all is eternal life always. And it stunned me. So what are you doing? Well, I'm stunned here because of this contemplative mystical breakthrough, this great breakthrough I've had of the good news. You can't do that. Get back to work. Get back to work. You know, they're committing suicide of the Apple, all the gadgets, you know, the Apple universities over there, the massive complexes of assembling all these gadgets we use, slave driving them every second of the day. Higher functionality, committing suicide, they just can't think. This is an abomination. This is an abomination. This world is an abomination, actually, very much so. Jesus didn't say, I didn't come to bring peace to this world, I came to condemn it. I came to bring a sword of being able to distinguish. I came to condemn this world, to condemn this ideal of works over grace. See, my capacity for works has just gotten less and less and less and less and less. Because I know my goal is to be supernature, which is an intermediate state. Healed perception is an intermediate situation. You still have perception, it's healed perception. But from there, you feel, well, I could go either way depending on whether God really did mandate that I define what I am or not. And from there, you can also accept that if God says, no, I did not mandate this, you say, oh, no problem. If God says, yes, I did mandate, you can say, well, it's not that big of a problem. I still have perception. So it's the safe place. It's the safe way. It's the sane and safe way. So this fake new age is about works. And you get all these people who are saying, hey, you know what, we used to be really against religion and stuff, but now we feel it's not so bad. In fact, I might even want to join a church, because now I see that their focus is on works, not this stupid eternal life. I can have eternal life now and this, because that's too stunning. I feel my functionality dropping. That's obviously not what God wants. God wants us to have super functionality here. That's what they say. Yeah, I kind of like religion. No, that's so bad. Let's all have a global religion. We should be able to get everyone on the same page. All agree that works is the way. Works is the way to salvation and our happiness. Just the way to super functionality here, right? We gotta have to have everybody. We can't have poor people with their functional malnutrition. We can't have poor functionality in this planet. We want everyone to be super functional here, so we can start designing space flights and space travel. And you know, we want to be a hub of super functionality, modern technology. Let's get everyone educated so we all can start working on gadgets. You know, this is their goal. So sure, there's no problem. Let's have a one world religion. We can do this. Everybody's And they think, this is the new age. We made it. We finally made it. And they'll celebrate it. They're celebrating. We made it. Oh, thank God. Yeah, we made it. Now we're so tolerant. We're tolerant to everybody because everybody's into good works, and we're into good works, and I'm okay, you're okay, because we're into super functionality. They say, hey, we all love one another. We're all happy. We're all getting along now. But This is great. We finally made the new age, the golden age of Aquarius. This is it. Peace and love and brotherhood, sisterhood. Wow. This is wonderful. Equality, tolerance for everything. We made it. And the only thing they sacrificed was the ideal of contemplation. Jesus on the cross being crucified. Yeah, just crucify Jesus and then we can reach the new age. Crucify the ideal of contemplation. Of course, Jesus was, he didn't give any signs of being super functional, did he? Now people say, well, what's wrong with this guy? He just kind of is very quiet and peaceful and says, love your enemy. And they're just saying this. I said, what? This isn't the gospel of super functionality. So surely people say, we made it. We're in the golden age and all we had to sacrifice is Jesus. That's it. The ideal of contemplation, the precious jewel, the world ideal of contemplation. All we had to do is sacrifice that. And that's no biggie, they say. That's no biggie. That's an anachronism anyway. Everybody's, they say, well, okay, we're good. We succeeded. Caught it. And of course, before you know it, vices. Being consumed with vices, suicide. Depression, anxiety. More and more pills. Brain, more and more laser surgery on the brain. So let's get rid of that God center, use lasers to eradicate those things, drugs to eradicate those things. Dystopian nightmares, what you're collapsing into. Not some glorious Aquarian new age. The writing is on the wall. For those who are not trying to be totally stupid, the writing is on the wall, crystal clear. And again, bureaucracy will regulate religion, making sure that their primary focus, in fact, their only focus, is good works. And making sure that this is what's being taught. And then they'll say, look how tolerant we are, religion. We're actually supporting it. Now they're regulating it to make sure it doesn't go back to supporting contemplation as the fundamental jewel ideal of this planet. Which means the culture supports it. And it says, absolutely we support this. This is all important for us. This is a sign that we're not totally stupid. Jesus came in this world and said, hey, guess what? You're not totally stupid because I came here. I wouldn't have come here if you're totally stupid because then you wouldn't be a waste. So the very fact that Jesus came to this planet means we're not totally stupid. And if you're not totally stupid, you will automatically begin to recognize the path of contemplation is your salvation. And it will automatically hold us up as the culture ideal. That's why I say monastic culture is the answer. Contemplative culture, monastic culture means contemplative culture, is the answer. So, the very fact that Jesus came to this planet means we're not totally stupid. Cosmic corporate culture is trying to insist that this is a myth, that Jesus didn't actually come here. It's all just a story. Well, some of it may have been spun into the various narratives, etc. But the fact that Jesus actually was here on this planet, you see, they're trying to say, no. Didn't never happen. Meaning, or we can succeed at being totally stupid. Otherwise, Jesus wouldn't have come here. So they say, no, he never came here. So we can at least this can succeed. And they'll try to do that with other teachers too. You know, they were never here. This is just all stories made by silly contemplatives being malfunctioning brain. They're claiming that all mysticism is brain malfunction. And these mystics didn't realize they had a brain malfunction. Maybe they ate some bad stuff or something, mushrooms or something. They had brain malfunction, whatever, and hallucinated all this stuff, and it never happened. And it affected their functionality in a negative way, so we don't want that anymore. This is where they're going. This is where this planet is going. But the very fact that Jesus did come here means Jesus knows, hey, We're not totally stupid. We can recognize that. It means the contemplative path is open for us. It means that we can put ourselves in a much more sane position where we're not so biased, actually, where we're not being affected by such severe bias. We can dwell in death-free realm, supernature. We can have the sparks of divine aware, even here in this world. We can be aware of this, even we can be vision of oneness is possible here. All this is possible for us because we're not totally stupid. Therefore, reason lives within us. And we'll say, hey, at least I can be a little bit smart. That's all it takes, just to be a little bit smart. So Jesus is saying, coming to this planet means we can be at least a little bit smart. We have that within us. Sure of it. So cosmic corporate culture is very much anti-Jesus. Even ever being here or coming here or being alive now or anything, they just want to say it's a myth. That he was just a good works rabbi, got married to Mary Magdalene, had lots of children, and was just really this happy, loving rabbi who said, everybody, do good works, that's the salvation, do more good works, that's the narrative that they're relentlessly promoting through all these magazines that they put out, through all these television programs, through these books they all put out, through the political narrative, the religious social narrative, all this stuff. They're promoting that, have been promoting it intensely for a long time. And especially through education, saying that your degree was earned because you're smart enough to realize this was all a myth. And that if you go backslide, maybe they'll pull their degree from you, you know. They say, whoops, looks like you don't deserve that degree anymore. You know, you went stupid. No, you realized, well, yeah, you went stupid, meaning you gave up the attempt to be totally stupid. Okay. They say, hey, what's wrong with you? You're stupid. You can't be stupid. What they're really meaning is you're supposed to be totally stupid, not just stupid. Because if you say I'm stupid, at least you're aware, smart enough to know that you're stupid. So you're not totally stupid, meaning that you got a little bit of intelligence, and a little bit of intelligence is all you need. So I guess when people say, hey, to me, hey, you're stupid. Thank you. What a compliment. At least I'm not trying to be totally stupid. So they're saying, you can't be stupid. You know, you can't be stupid. You need education to make yourself totally stupid. And I realized the goal, early on I realized the goal of education is to make me totally stupid. That's their goal. I said, I don't want to be totally stupid. So I'm going to stop paying attention to this. I'm going to start listening to the Holy Spirit. Wow. I'm going to start listening to wow. All right. Very great. Now I have to function in the world a little bit. So segue into that drive in Silicon Valley, you know. At least it's Christmas time, while the traffic won't be so terrible. Wow. Oh, wow. All right. So this has been great. This is very heavy stuff. That last part was the cherry on top. That's just terrific. Thank you for calling me stupid. That's a huge compliment. Tremendous compliment. Yes, I am stupid. Absolutely, yes, I am stupid. I'm just not totally stupid. And that's all it takes. It's all it takes. We're not trying to get rid of stupidity entirely. No. We're just trying to rest in a place where we're not totally stupid, so we can go either way if we need to, you see. Great. Very great. Very great. Very great. Appreciate all the viewers, you know, and hope that you're getting something out of this, absolutely, because I certainly am getting tremendous benefit from all this. Very great. That's it for this one.